Good evening, everyone, and welcome. I am Jackie Millay, honored to be the mayor of the city of Lone Tree. So I want to say thank you so much for leaning in and engaging on this very, very important project, which is not just going to serve the city of Lone Tree, but really the entire region. What we know for sure, there'll probably be less Lone Tree residents coming through the Lincoln Interchange than some of our neighboring communities. This is an entryway into Douglas County, and we could not be more proud to have it in our city, but we want it functioning and working appropriately today and into the future to guarantee the quality of life for our residents, our businesses, and to get people and goods moving through the community as efficiently as possible. So those of you who may or may not know me and my side gig, I actually am a civil engineer, so I do enjoy and geek out on these types of things. And this important piece of infrastructure we know is going to take years to develop. Critically important is partners, and that's why it's important to have the people in the room. And one of the most valuable partners to the city of Lone Tree is Douglas County. I could not be more honored to be introducing Commissioner Abe Layden with the Board of County Commissioners for Douglas County. He is a great advocate, not just for our city, but for this region. We are so blessed to have him as our leader, and I will now turn it over to him to make some opening remarks before we get to geek out on the engineering part of this and the planning phases. So, sir.
Thank you, Mayor, and it's an honor to be here. In my district, Lone Tree and Parker, we represent all of Douglas County, but we hail from three different districts. I'm one of your three county commissioners, and we are so honored by the service of Jackie Millay. I see Wynn Shaw and many wonderful members, and also Kathy Brunick. Who else from City of Lone Tree that I'm missing? But I live in Lone Tree, so I have a bit of a bias. And I often say that Lone Tree is the wonderful welcome sign to all of Douglas County. So this is a really important corridor, and we know that people are less concerned about growth when they have mobility. And so we're big fans of supporting our development community, supporting our citizens with amenities, and making sure that they have the mobility that they need to get going where they need to go. Huge fan of Denver South, sit on that board as well. Very thankful for Jackie's leadership and the leadership of many in that organization. So thank you for having me. We are honored to be partners with Lone Tree and Denver South. So thank you and welcome to the public. Looking forward to the discussion. Thanks.
Well, thank you very much, both Mayor and Commissioner, on introducing everybody. And we are, my name is Justin Schmitz. I'm the Director of Public Works and Mobility for the City of Lone Tree. And I love geeking out on transportation projects too, just like the Mayor. So we're really excited today to introduce a project that's been long in the works between the county and the city. I was actually thinking about this interchange and my experiences with it personally. And I realized three different times I had to rush through this interchange trying to introduce a new member of my family at Sky Ridge Medical Center. And each time that it happened, right, it got more and more busy at the interchange. And I remember parts of it. I was mainly trying to go really quick, right, to get there. But this is the type of reason it's such an important interchange. You know, this is not just a way to get through, right? It's a place to go. There are destinations within the city of Lone Tree, within Douglas County, exactly the gateway that the commissioner mentioned. These are the type of things that we're gonna be talking about today through the presentation and what really make this an important project. I did wanna highlight real quick some of the team here that is helping to deliver this project. So in the back over here, we have Dan Rain. He is the city's project manager, our mobility manager as well. So that's right, our mobility manager is helping to manage this project because we're looking at how all modes are gonna move through this interchange and make sure we deliver it correctly. We also have Zeke Lynch from Douglas County, who's serving as Douglas County's project manager, as well as Ronnie Roybal, who's our design engineer. As we get further down this project, these type of projects start with a lot more planning, ideas, creation. Then they start turning into the engineering side, right? The real nuts and bolts of the project. So throughout this project, you'll see that transition. And as we come and present data and information, you'll continue to see it get more refined and more into the engineering world as we move forward. So with that, I'm very excited to introduce our project team. So we did bring on an amazing company to work with, Wilson & Company. And with that, I'm going to introduce the better looking partner over here, John Chesser, who is our project manager. So John, take us away. Thank you.
Thanks, Justin. I don't know about better looking, but I will tell you, it's what you guys are seeing here tonight from everybody is energy. There's a lot of energy on this team. And I love it because that's where I'm at home. It's been a lot of fun being a part of the city and the county and all of the stakeholders that it's going to take to bring this project forward. It's an amazing team. I'm excited to be able to talk to you a little bit about the project process and where we're headed over the next few years and what that could potentially turn into. We are early, and that's a great place to be because we are open to all different kinds of comments, all different kinds of ideas, all different kinds of feedback on what is needed out here. What is needed at I-25 in Lincoln? I live in Highlands Ranch. I use this interchange 4 or 5 times a week, headed everywhere, sometimes headed locally, sometimes headed way not locally. And so this regional and local balance is something we've been talking a lot about as a team. It's something you're going to hear a lot about through the life of this project. There's a lot of different users for this corridor, for Lincoln Avenue and this interchange. And it's really important that we're thinking about everybody as we look ahead. We're not looking at what exists right now and saying, how do we do something that makes sense for today? We're going to be looking out to 2050. That's the horizon year. That's the design year for transportation projects now. And it's not about where we are now. It's about where we're going to be in 2050 and how do we make this the best possible situation for everybody. So before we get too far into the details, a couple logistics. We have a number of folks that are joining us virtually right now through a Zoom call. So welcome everybody who's joining us virtually. We're really excited to have you here. In this new world that we live in, the idea of engaging with people in different ways is changing. We have folks here in person that want to come and feel the vibe of another human being and sit down and kind of power through some role plots and kind of look at what's going on out here. And we have other folks, I'm sure, sitting at home with their iPad, in their pajamas on their couch. And we want to reach everybody. And we want a process that's going to engage everybody and allow folks to feel comfortable engaging in however it's best to do that for them. So the folks that are joining us online, please know that we do have somebody monitoring the Q&A. We encourage you, as time goes on through the presentation, send in comments, send in questions. We're collecting them all. At the end of this presentation piece, we will be doing a Q&A. Folks here in the room, folks virtually, we're gonna bounce back and forth and we're gonna hopefully hear from some people and get the project team engaged in answering some questions about where we are and where we're going. So please make use of that Q&A function, send in your comments, send in your questions, and the project team will receive them. We're gonna talk about ways to stay involved. There are many, many ways to stay engaged in this project, and that's done on purpose. Again, we want to make sure everybody has the ability to engage in the way that makes sense for them. So we're going to talk about that here as we get towards the end. Let's get into the good stuff. Let's talk about this project a little bit and where we're headed. So why are we here? Why are we talking about Lincoln Avenue? Why are we talking about the I-25 interchange? I don't know if you've noticed, but there's some growth happening in the area. And there's more to come. There's a lot more to come. And there's residential, there's commercial, there's retail, there's all different kinds of mixed use growth that's happening. And the system that we have out here today on Lincoln and through the I-25 interchange is not capable of handling it all. And so we've got to look ahead. Does that mean we're only looking at vehicles? Absolutely not. You heard earlier from, I believe it was Justin and Commissioner Layden who mentioned, we got to look at all modes. We got to look at pedestrians, bicycles. We got to look at different kinds of vehicles that are coming. It's important that what we do here embraces all modes, embraces everybody. With more people, with more jobs, comes more travel needs and more needs for options in how you travel. Whether you're working locally through the interchange or regionally, coming from Parker and wanting to go north up to Denver, it's got to be able to accommodate everything. So we're going to be planning for the long term here. You'll notice that on this slide, this is our project purpose and need. This is our purpose statement. This is why we're here. You also notice that in the title, it says draft. That is very, very important. This is not a finished product. We are going to learn from the engagement that we have with the public, with our stakeholders, with the community on what is needed out here. What are the problems? What are we trying to address? We have a pretty good handle on a place to start. And that's what you see here today. But this is going to sort of evolve with us as we move through the project. You're going to hear a little bit later about our NEPA process. It's an environmental clearance process. We will revisit the purpose and need statement for the NEPA process when we have an alternative, when we have a recommended package of improvements that we want to take forward. We're going to take a look at this again and make sure that we're not missing anything. So what you read here today is a good place to start. It helps form where we're headed with this process, but it is not the end of the story. So pay attention to that as time goes on. This information will be up on the project website. We encourage folks to comment on it in the multitude of ways that we're going to talk about. And we want to know, we want to hear, because we want to grow this project. We want to learn from folks as we go through. The project goals on the right, again, high level project goals. We know we can't do anything out here without improving safety. Has to be paramount. Safety does not just mean for people in cars. I was talking to a gentleman earlier today, here at one of the boards, and biking through the I-25 interchange on Lincoln is not a comfortable experience today. And we'd like it to be. Right? So it's part of safety. It's part of where we're headed with the conversation. Obviously, we're going to be looking at existing and projected traffic congestion, improving operations, again, for all modes to move through the interchange, whether it's regionally or locally, and then enhancing multimodal travel and connectivity. Connectivity is a huge piece. We've got to understand where people are and where they want to go, origin, destination. And that's huge. That's really important because we could help them get there. All right, a little bit about how we got to where we are today. Obviously, a lot happened before 2007. This interchange was first built in the mid-50s and has evolved over time with different updates. But in 2007, a really important thing happened, and that was an initial study that looked at Lincoln Avenue and looked at the I-25 and Lincoln interchange to start identifying improvements. Yeah, this was 14 years ago, almost 15 years ago now, and the need was there then. As you started looking out to 2025, that used to be the horizon year, 2035. Now we're up to 2050, the need is still here. But what that project did, or what that study did, was allow us to take a look at what's necessary in the short term and what's potentially necessary in the long term. So after that study was finished, 2010, 2013, a number of different short-term improvements, things at the intersections at Lincoln and Park Meadows Drive. A lot of necessary components to helping operations were implemented. And that was huge to make sure that the operations could survive, could live through, but it didn't address the long-term needs of Lincoln Avenue and the interchange. And that's where Douglas County and City of Lone Tree and Denver South and other stakeholders got together and said, it's time to start looking at the long-term solution for this area. And that's where we are today. The agencies were able to secure some funding to start studying that long-term vision. And we're again, at Wilson and Company, we're thrilled to be a part of this team to help take a look at that vision and see what we can do here looking out to 2050. So, where we are today is we kicked off this project a few months ago. We've been really building towards this public engagement piece right from day one. It was really important to all the agencies that we set that up as the foundation of the project before we do anything else. And so we have been. We've been working to get to today for this public meeting. We've been building a website that promotes a tremendous amount of engagement, a lot of different ways for folks to leave comments, leave suggestions, leave ideas. It's not just a problem, a situation where we want you to come and present the issues. If you have ideas, if you have potential solutions, if you have things you'd like to see, we want to hear that. So we're going to talk about a few of those as we go on, but that's where we are today. Where we're going to be going, over the next few months, we're going to develop a whole world of alternatives. That's going to take a look at all different aspects of moving people, goods, and services through this corridor and through this interchange. And that's going to take a lot of different forms. So the reason we build that world of alternatives is so that we can start screening them. We can start whittling down to what makes the most sense. So between now and about May of next year, spring of next year, we're going to be going through a multi-tiered analysis where we take that world of alternatives, we get it down to about two or three. We can do a robust traffic analysis, traffic operations analysis on those two or three. A little bit hard to do it with more than that because it is time consuming and is an expensive process. We get down to about those three. We run through that heavy duty traffic analysis, which includes multimodal, includes bike, ped, transit, all modes. And the idea is to come up with a recommended package of improvements spring of next year. And when I say package of improvements, that's on purpose because it's, again, not just about vehicles and what we can do with the roadway system. We're talking about trails, connectivity. How do we get people to the light rail stations? How do we get people to the retail areas they want to be? How do we get them home once they're in these places? So it's an idea that this package of improvements is going to address as much of that as we can and set maybe future projects up for tremendous amount of success as well. It's really important that we do that because, you know, we're not going to be able to accomplish every single thing with this project. We can do a lot and we can set a lot up for success that's going to come in the future. So we get this alternative. We're going to work through the NEPA process. I mentioned that earlier. That's an evaluation of the environmental impacts and mitigation that's necessary for an improvement like the one that's going to be recommended. In order for that to be implemented, what are we looking at? That process takes a little while. That's going to get us into the end of 2022, early 2023. From there, we are going to get to about 30% design. It's called preliminary design of that recommended alternative that has now been cleared through the federal NEPA process. That is funded now. That whole process is funded now with this effort. That's massive. And the city and the county and Denver South and the stakeholders deserve a tremendous amount of credit for getting the funding necessary to get this initiative to that place in about 2.5 years. We're looking at the end of 2023 to have 30% design for a package of improvements. That's great. That's amazing. But it's not the end of the story. What we really want to do is get something implemented that the public can use. And that's going to take us through final design and then eventually construction. Those phases are not yet funded. However, the city and the county and other stakeholders are working on that as we speak. We're not going to wait to the end to try to find that money. It's happening now. And what we're going to be doing over the next couple of years is going to put us in a tremendous position to be able to be attractive for that money. Because make no mistake, we are competing. Money doesn't grow on trees. We have to compete for the money that's out there. And the work we're doing now is going to put us in position to do that. So again, kind of breaking it into a couple pieces here with this first phase that's going to get us through identifying and screening alternatives. We want that single recommended alternative, that package of improvements that we can take forward then into NEPA and eventually preliminary design. The idea is that as we are able to complete this federal review process, we become even more attractive for money, for funding. Okay, so what we're doing in the background that you don't see here tonight is a tremendous amount of data collection. This is a huge project. This is a huge effort. We showed this slide not so that you necessarily have to read every single word that's on it. It's to illustrate the massive amount of data that's being collected in order for us to make really good decisions. We want to hear from the public. We want to know what's going on. We also need to know a lot about what's happening in the area and what's projected to happen in the future. That's going to allow this team and the agencies involved to make really great decisions as we go along about screening alternatives down to those two or three, and then what we do when we get to that endpoint, so that we know when we get to that recommended alternative, it's something everybody can stand behind. That's huge because unified local support is the number one thing that you need for funding. And if you don't have a good foundation of public engagement and data to support your process, it's a lot harder. So there's a lot going on. Right now, we've collected data. You may have seen folks out in their vests out on Lincoln Avenue collecting traffic data in mid-October. We have bike and ped data that's being collected. We have survey that's about to get started. You're going to see our survey folks out there understanding where we are from a utilities perspective, what's out there now, what's coming with potential development. you know, and the utilities that are necessary for that, there's a lot that goes into it. And so we're going to be building all of that data collection, that foundation, so that when we develop and screen these alternatives, we're doing it with the right information. Throughout this entire process, it is absolutely critical that we engage and hear from everyone, not just the funding partners, not just the stakeholders who have land interests nearby, but the users of this corridor, the users of this interchange, whether it's local or regional, however it needs to be. We want to hear from you. And right now, at this early stage of the project, there's a few things that we want to know. What problems do you know are out here today, right? What ideas do you have to maybe fix those problems? You know, what conditions exist that are going to influence what we can do for improvements? How do you use the corridor today? How would you use the corridor in the future if you could design it yourself, right? Right now, not a comfortable ride for folks to be able to get through the interchange on a bike, but there's people out there that want to. And what does that look like? We want to hear from you. We want to understand what we can do to be able to make this a corridor that is comfortable and safe for all users. So it's important that we engage. There's a lot of different ways that we're going to engage. And we're going to pump you guys or push you guys to the project website every chance we get. AdvancingLincolnAvenue.com. That is the hub of this project. It's where we're going to communicate with you guys. It's where we're going to communicate with the public. It's where we're going to receive information back from the public. There's all kinds of features on there to be able to provide information in the way that feels most comfortable to you. We have a project hotline. Mr. Dan Raines spent hours and hours working on the message for that hotline. We want people to call it. We want people to hear his voice and be inspired to leave information. So we have a project email. We have a mapping feature on the website. We have all different kinds of ways for folks to engage. We'll get to more of that later. So what happens once we get that package of that alternative package, that package of improvements? We get to final design. It takes a little while, right? It takes a couple years to get through final design. This is not going to be a simple solution here. It's going to be complex. It's going to have many layers. It's important that we spend the time getting it right on the design side. So the funding that the city and the county are searching for right now, the first piece is that final design piece. That could potentially take place in 2024, 2025. This current phase that is funded wraps up at the end of 2023. So if that funding's available and the project can roll right into final design, the idea is for that to take place 24, 25, which means construction could start potentially as early as 2026. Again, completely funding dependent at this point. So we have funding to get through a recommended alternative, design it to about 30%, and then we're hard at work to find the rest. It's a common question we get at this stage of the project. When's the shovel going in the ground? Right? We don't know yet. It's important that we go through these next couple of years to be able to get to a point so we can answer that question and we can find people that want to invest in this improvement. That's a big deal. All right, I've mentioned it all the way through. Folks mentioned it at the beginning. There's a lot of different ways to engage in this project. Again, the website's going to be the central hub of everything. We do have an interactive map feature that went live this morning. Chris, can you go ahead and pull that up? So this is our project website. This is the homepage. As you scroll down towards the bottom, you get past the first picture. We're kind of working through some information, a little bit about schedule there. Public meeting is tonight. We get to this section. This is a call to action section. This is where we want folks to feel inspired to be able to leave comments. Chris, go ahead and click on that map for me if you would. This is going to bring up an interactive map feature where anybody can come in and leave a comment, leave a idea, a suggestion about the project site. It looks like one of our layers must have got turned off at some point because we're supposed to have a study area and an area for improvements around. Like, oh, there they are. Must be a Wi-Fi thing. This is one of the coolest features that we have available for folks to provide comments. You can zoom all the way in to a, you can find Hacienda, Colorado. You could zoom all the way in on it. You could drop a comment that says, don't you dare touch Hacienda, Colorado. my family probably be the first ones to comment on that exact thing. Justin talks about getting through the interchange, you know, to bring new life into the world. My three kids love Hacienda and we live in Highlands Ranch. So we got to get through this interchange to get to food. That's a big deal. So again, you can zoom in, you can zoom out. Chris, if you could just click on the make a comment icon at the top and drag it down to any point on the map real quick and just leave it there. Right there sounds great. We're not going to leave a comment tonight, but this is how you can leave a comment. All we ask is you provide your name and your email address. Again, we're going to have the ability to sort this information, to look for keywords, to, on the left-hand side where it says about an activity, we can put polls, we can ask questions, we can prompt people to provide different kinds of information. This is going to be a major central piece of us engaging with everybody in this area. It's huge. It's also fun, right? You get to drag and leave your comment anywhere you want. You can say pretty much anything you want. It will kick out cuss words, just so you're aware. And you have the ability to upload a picture. So if you have something very specific, like, hey, in the winter, this is a low spot, water collects, it gets icy, and you want to take a picture of it, you can snap a picture and put it here. The project team has to approve all pictures before they go up there, just so everybody knows. But again, what an amazing way for us to engage with people in the way that makes most sense to them. Chris, thank you. Can we go back to the slides? So you can sign up to receive email updates where we will provide information saying, hey, we've completed level one screening. Come to the website and check out the information. You can email the project team at info@advancinglincolnavenue.com. You can call us and hear Dan's wonderful voice. Again, lots of different ways to engage. If you've heard us say it once, you've heard us say it 1,000 times. This is the foundation of the project. This is how it's going to succeed, is hearing from the public, engaging with the public, the stakeholders, the community at large, understanding what's going on so that now and in the future so that we can be successful in coming up with a package of improvements to help this corridor. All right, appreciate it. We have Joy Wassendorf with CIG, one of our project partners, has been monitoring the Q&A online. We also have Dan Rain here with a microphone.
Usually a dangerous combination.
Right. So we'd love to hear if folks have comments, ideas, suggestions, questions tonight. We have a number of folks here in the room. We have a number of folks online. Dan, why don't we ask first if there's anybody here in the room that has a question for the project team? Lots of folks here to be able to answer if you have something.
Would anyone like to ask a question?
Sir, in front?
John, you did too good of a presentation.
That's scary. Well, let's ask Joy online if Joy has any questions here that have come in through the Q&A on the virtual portion.
Yeah, John, can you hear me, John?
We can. Welcome
all
to
right.
The meeting, Joy.
Thank you. It looks like we've got 8 folks online. We do have a couple questions. One of them you've kind of answered, but you might want to reiterate all the resources that are out there. But somebody asked, how can I sign up to be informed or notified of future public outreach meetings?
Oh, yes. The project website. Chris, if we could pull up the website one more time on the homepage. Let's go right to the top of the homepage, if you would. So there's a nice green bar here underneath this picture of Lincoln Avenue that is going to be constantly updated with the most pertinent information about where we are with the project. So if there's a public meeting coming up, it's going to say it there. This project website is going to be full of information all the way throughout. We're going to add tabs to the top, but right now there's a tab at the top called Public Meetings. The materials from this public meeting, the video of the virtual presentation, the copies of the boards, all of this information is going to be uploaded to the project website after a meeting happens, and information about upcoming meetings will always be here. So lots of different ways to be able to stay engaged and know where we're at, not just for public meetings, but I encourage everybody to check in often as we update the project website with data, with information as we receive it, as we work through the screening process and we're ready to let everybody know where we're at. There's going to be a lot of updates as we go through.
You know, also, if you do want to speak to a real person, just call the number and leave a voicemail and we'll get right back to you.
Absolutely. And then you get to hear Dan's message.
And you can also sign up for the email list and have the news come to you.
Yep, absolutely. So there's a feedback tab at the top of the website on the far right next to the phone number. In that feedback tab on the far right, again, stay informed, sign up for updates. Guys, this is easy. There are so many different ways for you to be able to engage with us, and we're really, really looking forward to it. So make use of one or all of them if you'd like.
All right,
Joy, another one more question?
Yeah, we got a couple more here online. Somebody asks, will various components of the Ultimate Project be constructed in phases? So in other words, maybe bike and ped components, could they be built earlier than some of the major elements to improve those first and last mile connections to things like busting and light rail?
Absolutely. So that is, I love that question / comment saying, hey, can we please do something like this in the form of a question? I love it. So the idea when we get to that time frame that had 2026 on there and said construction, the idea is we're going to talk about that as implementation of projects in plural until we know. And so we know what the package of improvements looks like. And so we know what early action items can be identified in there and how the funding is going to come in. I mean, there's a chance you could get funding for the whole thing all at once. That happens. And we're going to position ourselves to be attractive for all of that. But the money could come in over time as well. It can come in chunks, which means the project ultimately gets built in phases. Part of our process as we go through here is going to be looking at priorities. It's going to be looking at early action, potential ways to phase the improvements. And we invite folks to let us know what they think the priorities should be for early action items. I heard from Joy's comment, sounds like there was multiple pieces to it, talking about first mile, last mile, getting connection points. That's that multimodal connectivity that we talked about. There are options to phase this and probably likely depending on how funding comes in.
All right,
looks we got a question. Hold on 1 second, Joy. We got a question from somebody in the audience here. Let's jump over to Dan, who's walking the microphone that way.
So I saw a couple of times where you mentioned sustainability. What is your metric for defining that?
We're working on it. So one of the things that we do after tonight, when we have the draft purpose statement that's out there, is we develop evaluation criteria. And evaluation criteria is going to be how we measure the alternatives against each other as we go through the screening process. We've got a pretty good start on it, but we need to dig deeper. We need to refine it. We need to get specific. As we go through the levels of screening, it gets from a high level qualitative type of analysis into a much more quantitative type of analysis. So as we spend time over the next month to 6 weeks, getting into the evaluation criteria is on the table. And so as we define exactly what metrics we're going to use to look at sustainability, that's where it's gonna show up. Now, a couple things that just kind of come into mind. Sustainability is a big buzzword. It means a lot of different things. We are going to be looking out to 2050. This has got to be something that's going to last. We've got to be looking at improvements that are going to make sense, not just for what's there now, but as the development in the area of this corridor comes into being, what does that do for us to be able to understand where those people are, where those people want to go, how are their trips going to influence what happens in this corridor and on that interchange? So we've got to be looking long-term. We've got to be looking big. We cannot look at this and think we can solve the problem by addressing vehicles only. That's not going to happen. Part of sustainability is being able to look at all modes so that folks in have options for how they want to move through this corridor, how they want to move through this interchange. I know those are really big picture, high level ideas, but sustainability is a big picture, high level word. We welcome folks that have ideas on that to bring those forward to the project team, but we will be diving into the details on it as part of our evaluation criteria here in the next month or two.
You know, I'd also like to add sustainability also means longevity, that the investment lasts 50, 75 years. And not only are we evaluating that as part of like alternatives analysis, even the criteria for considering alternatives, but when we go for funding through Dr. Cog, they evaluate that as well. We'll be competing actively with folks downstream on 25, North Stream on 70 as well for these types of projects. And with the new greenhouse gas rulings that are out and published and being considered, it's a lot of criteria we have to meet. So the projects of old and in the day where you just expand and widen and make it a bigger roadway for auto traffic, they're being put behind us now, and we have to be thinking much more about moving people and goods.
Very well said, Dan. Any other comments from the group here before we jump back on virtual? Excellent. Joy, do you have another question for us?
Yeah, we have one more here. This is kind of a long-range schedule-related question. It's in regards to the development on the east side of I-25 adjacent to Lincoln Avenue. The question is, will this project be completed before the Ridgegate development takes access off of Lincoln Avenue?
It's a great question. I'm going to start, and then I'll hand it over to Dan to or others to be able to weigh in on this as well, as I know the city and the county are working closely with the developer. So timing is going to be interesting. Funding is going to determine timing on both sides of that conversation. As I mentioned before, we're funded to get this project to 30% design at the end of 2023. We're working with the developer and the Metro District there on the east side of I-25 to understand where they're going to be at that time, so we can work together on what makes sense for this community. Beyond that, we are not funded for final design and construction, so I don't know when those improvements are going to go into place and where the development will be at that time. What I can tell you is, as part of our leadership and technical committees for this project, the Rampart Range Metro District and Coventry, the developer, are on both. They will be a part, they have been a part of this conversation from the beginning. They will be all the way through, so that we can make sure that we are designing improvements that make sense for everybody involved. It doesn't do us any good to do something that the developer can't work with, or that nixes one of the plans that they have down the road. It's going to take a lot of people. We talked about that at the very beginning. And that's a really great example of that. So timing wise, we don't know yet, but we have them in our committees as part of this project. So when they know, we'll know. And that's going to be huge. So Dan, I don't know if you have anything you want to add to that.
Fortunately, I do. That was great, John, because you summarized it. And having these folks heavily involved in the project at the get-go is really critical for us being able to inform that criteria for evaluating what works best in this Ford Lincoln Avenue. And in particular, we just had a first technical committee where the developer was there developing what their plans are and what kind of growth we're expecting. And it is significant. So with all that and them on board at the get-go, we feel like we can develop and evaluate concepts to a preferred alternative that can encompass and address and all that growth for project longevity.
Yes, it looks like Justin has a comment that he'd like to jump in with as well.
Yeah, no, that's great. And the one thing I was going to add is, you know, within the city of Lone Tree, one of the goals is always to have our infrastructure and our transportation system built in coordination or in advance of the development. So that's why this project is in place. You can see a light rail station, right, that is built and ready for the development to come in. These are investments that have been made. Ridgegate Parkway through the same area was widened from 2 lanes to 6 lanes to accommodate both current traffic and future growth that's coming from the new development. So this is really that next step, right? We've done a lot of work to get our infrastructure ready for this new development, but now it's time to get this interchange as well and continue to move it forward. So, you know, we can never, like John mentioned, we can never know the future, but we always try to prepare ourselves to be ready for the future. And that's what this project's doing.
So much of getting to the right answers, having the right people in the room, and I got to give credit to the city and the county, you know, Dan and Justin, Zeke and Art Griffith with the county. That started years ago, getting the right people in the room. And that didn't bring that involves CDOT. I mean, this is I-25 goes right through the middle of this corridor, right? You cannot have these conversations without CDOT. You cannot have these conversations without the developers. We've got to have the right people in the room, and we do. And that's what's really exciting about where we're headed with this. Joy, other comments that you may have online?
Yeah, there's two more here. I'm going to kind of lump these together. They're both related to travel reliability and congestion. The questions specifically are, will the project address congestion at Park Meadows Drive, and will the project improve signal progression along the corridor?
The answer is yes. We will be looking at traffic operations throughout this whole corridor from Park Meadows Drive on Lincoln all the way through east to Oswego, through the Oswego intersection as well. You can't address congestion on Lincoln Avenue without looking at the intersections, without looking at the ramp terminals from I-25 and understanding how they all work together to make this happen. If you remember back, I kind of jumped back here to the purpose slide where we had our project goals in there as well. On the right-hand side, address existing and projected traffic congestion. What we have now is not going to get better on its own. So we have to look at future projections and improving operations on Lincoln Avenue in this corridor and through the interchange. So these are primary goals of the project, is to look at operations again. How do we get people, goods, and services through as efficiently as possible to where they want to be? Do they have the right connections? You know, do we have the right signal progression as one idea? That's something that is constantly being looked at the agencies. You know, ways to improve signal progression, you know, through existing intersections as they are today. And we will definitely be looking at all of that to improve congestion and operations with this project. It's one of the main goals that we have. Joy, any other questions that have popped in online?
That's it for the online right now.
Okay. Any other questions from folks in the room? Doesn't look like it. So I wanted to thank everybody for being a part of this tonight. This is just the start of a really exciting process. I encourage everybody here and everybody that's joined us virtually to stay engaged on the project. Visit our website frequently, sign up for those alert updates. We're going to be providing information as often as we can when we have information to give. So if you don't hear from us for a little while, it's probably because we got our heads in the sand and we're trying to figure some things out. There's going to be a lot of that on this project. As we come out of that and we have information for everybody, we're going to use the website to communicate that to folks. The next public meeting that we plan on having, similar to tonight, is probably going to be in the spring when we have information to tell you about how the alternative screening process has worked and sort of what we're seeing coming out of that. So tonight's all about kicking off a really great project. The next time we see you guys in person here for the public meeting, as we have scheduled now, we will have some results for you. We'll have some more information for you, and that gives a lot for people to react to. So on behalf of the city, the county, all the project stakeholders, Wilson and company, thank you guys so much for being a part of this. And I really look forward to engaging with you throughout the life of this project. It's going to be a fun one. So thank you.